إكرامي سيد الأكوان هو المنان الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله. الحمد لله على نعمة الإسلام وكفى بها نعمة. الحمد لله على منة الولاية وكفى بها منة. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن سيدنا وعظيمنا وحبيب قلوبنا النبي المؤيد والرسول المسدد والمصطفى الأمجد والمحمود الأحمد حبيب إله العالمين أبي القاسم محمد صلوات الله وسلامه عليه وعلى آل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين سفن النجاة الأعلام، من ركب سفينتهم نجا ومن تخلف عنها هلك وغرق. ثم أما بعد، respected elders, brothers and sisters, السلام عليكم جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته. Allow me again to take this opportunity to offer my heartfelt condolences to صاحب العصر والزمان عجل الله تعالى فرجه الشريف on this sad and sorrowful occasion marking the martyrdom anniversary of none other than Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayh. I will take a recourse again to go and speak about religion at a later stage, but today I will speak and take your leave to speak about Amir al-Mu'mineen salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayh. We were saying that Amir al-Mu'mineen salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayh, in his way of dealing with people last 2 days and yesterday as well, we spoke a little bit and touched upon the life of Amir al-Mu'mineen salawatullahi wa salamu alayh. He had the habit of equating himself, though he was Amir al-Mu'mineen, though he was in the post of leadership, though he was in the rank which no one among the companion of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam or those who came after the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would have reached the status and the position that Amir al-Mu'mineen salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi reached, but he was always of the opinion and of the belief that he must equate himself with those who are at the most average of all average in his community. Because he was of the belief that if you lead, you must lead by way of showing your subjects and citizens that you are at the same level as they are. There's no differences between you and them. But what is so amazing about Amir al-Mu'mineen salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi is not the fact that he was able to equate himself with the most average among his citizens, but his ability to even give justice and emit justice with his opponent. And that is the difficult thing to achieve. Now, we can't even establish justice with our loved one, let alone to establish justice with those that we don't like or those that we feel that they have hatred against us or animosity against us or those who usurp our right. Yet Imam Ali would extend to them a heart and a word of goodness on the basis of what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught. So much so that among his golden words that echo until today is the following statement in which he was speaking to a group of his friends, and he says to them, oblige your brother by warning them, correct them by showing and giving them favors. You should tie the knot of love and affection with your brother, remembering that your brother is not strong enough to break the knots, nor is he capable in harming you. Again, he says something else which is phenomenal, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi, in which he says, it is in the nature of a brave man to ignore the mistakes he has seen in others. It is not honorable when someone makes a mistake to always rejoice at his mistake. It is not honorable that when you see someone slipping, that you remind him of that slip day and night. No. You should in fact do everything in your power to conceal that slip and shortcoming. رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم used to say and encourage the Muslims to learn this habit, which is in fact a habit from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What is that habit? كتم السر. What is كتم السر? Concealing the secrets of others. For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala conceals our secrets. He knows that we sin by the day. He knows that we sin by the night. Yet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not immediately, the minute you make a mistake, He lashes at you and He says, I got you. I was waiting for you to slip so I can get at you. No. On the contrary, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala issues His orders to the malaika that when my servant sins, allow him respite until night time. If he sins by the day, or if he sins by night, allow him respite till the morning and don't record anything against him. Why? Perchance he will come back to me. Perchance he will come back to me. So if he comes back to me, there is no need to write it. Right? Why do you have to work overtime? My angels write to erase. You don't need to. Huh? Just don't write it until we see what can happen with this person. And Amir al-Mu'mineen salawatullahi wasalamu alayhi used to overcome or overlook the mistakes of people, except when it came to the question of governing. When it came to one of his governors being in a post of governmanship, Amir al-Mu'mineen was extremely particular. Why? Because now it is the haqq of these subjects to be ruled on the basis of fairness and equity. So you cannot mess around with the hukuk of people. You cannot mess around with being unfair to people or bringing forward those who are close to you on the basis that you are related to them and now you are in a position of power to favor them. No, you can't do that. In the books of Amir al-Mu'mineen, because the books of Amir al-Mu'mineen are the books of the Quran, right? Amir al-Mu'mineen himself used to say, this book that you call the Quran is the silent word of Allah. And I am the spoken word of Allah. Meaning what? Meaning that Ali ibn Abi Talib in his action was Quran incarnate. So if you see Amir al-Mu'mineen salamullah alayhi, you see the Quran walking on earth. Just like the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was, like when one of his wives was asked about his character. What was the character of the Prophet at home? Did the Prophet get angry at home? Did the Prophet yell at home? Did the Prophet scream? Did the Prophet shout? Did the Prophet swear? Did the Prophet abuse verbally or physically or emotionally? The wives of the Prophet were asked, what was the behavior of the Prophet at home? Each and every one of them replied, كَانَ خُلُقُهُ الْقُرْآنِ. His moral system was that of the Qur'an. He would not side an inch away from the Quran. The Imams of Ahlul Bayt, Salamullahi Alayhim Ajma'in, they used to follow the Quran to the letter. So much so that one of the workers in the house of Imam Zainul Abideen, Salawatullahi wa Salamu Alayhi, once brought Imam Zainul Abideen something, food or water, something of that nature, but it was hot. In the course of delivering that particular vessel to the Imam, she tripped and dropped the hot water on the Imam. What did she say? This worker is raised in the house of the Imam. Yani now, by now, she knows how the Imam behaves because she learned from the character of the Imam. Right? When you live with someone, whether it's a maid, whether it's a worker, whether it's a son, whether it's a wife, whether these people learn from your character. So this worker learned from the characteristics of Zainul Abideen salawatullahi wasalam. Immediately upon dropping the vessel on Zainul Abideen salawatullahi wasalamu alayhi, what did she say? Immediately she said to Imam Zainul Abideen, والكاظمين الغيظ, those who suppress their anger. It's an ayah in the Quran. Sajjad Salamullah alayh did not get angry and says, you're teaching me the Quran now. He says, لَقَدْ كَذَمْنَا غَيْظَنَا. We have already suppressed our anger. Then she said to him, وَالْكَاظِمِينَ الْغَيْظُ وَالْعَافِينَ عَنِ النَّاسِ. And those who forgive. Zain al-Abidin said, and I have already forgiven. Then she said, وَاللَّهُ يُحِبُّ الْمُحْسِنِينَ. And Allah loves the generous one. Brothers, this is not just slogans. These are not just lustrous slogans that we take from the minbar so we can say, ah, wah, 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 mashallah, Ahlul Bayt. Nare Haydari. Right? No. It's not about this. I don't want to come and sit here and relate to your stories so someone will come, Nare Haydari. No. I want to educate myself first so that I become Haydari. Salawatullahi wasalamu alayhi. And everyone else assumes the character of that Imam. Salawatullahi wasalamu alayhi. So here a lady saying to the Imam that you must what? Suppress your anger. You must forgive me and you must be generous to me. Yani I make the fault. I drop the hot water and I end up getting 1,000 dinar from you. Can you imagine? So the Imam said what? Here is 1,000 dinar and you are free for the sake of Allah. She said, and do you think I would leave the house of the household of the Prophet? No, no. And I don't want. But I learned these characteristics from your behavior. So if you live with someone for 40 years and he does not benefit from your company, that means you had no impact on that person. Nil, zilch, zero. Right? And then what do? Then we blame the people we live with that they don't listen. They don't understand. We have to repeat ourselves a million times so that they will understand. But do we understand ourselves the value of morality? Right? That when the wife tells us day in or day out, or day in or day out, please, Habibi, John, don't yell at me. Wallah, I am as a human as you are. Why are you screaming at me? You think I am a wall, I'm a pillar, I'm a brick. No, I'm a human being. Come and talk to me, I will talk to you. Dialogue. I often have, you know, sisters coming over for marriage counseling at home, back home in Australia, or brothers, and they said, my wife doesn't listen. I say, tell me something, how long have you been married to your wife? They said, 10 years. I said, in all honesty, there is no one between you and me except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The wife is not here. How many times did you sit to your wife and had a conversation with her about something that is bothering you? They said, never. I said, then how will she know what you want? How will she learn about your inner feelings and what bothers you and what you like and what you dislike? I appeal to the younger generation. When you want to get married, sit with your future wife or future husband and sit a list of pros and cons, likes and dislikes, so that you get to know one another. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran says what? وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ. And among his signs is he created mates for you from amongst yourself. Yani what does that mean? Yani he created you wives for you or husband from your own species. You're not gonna marry a genie. You're not gonna marry an angel. She is full of emotion like you are full of emotion. She is full of likes and dislikes just like you are full of likes and dislikes. So he created someone from your own kind. Why? So you may have a tug of war at home. No, he didn't say that. Subhanallah. So that you pull towards you and she pulls towards her. Right? No, he said, وَجَعَلَ بَيْنَكُمْ مَوَدَّةً وَرَحْمَةً. And he placed between your hearts love and mercy. Brothers, this is Quran, not Hollywood and Pollywood. Quran, Allah says, and he placed love and mercy between your hearts. I'm not talking about the Titanic now with Twilight, or God knows what. I'm talking about the Quran. Tayyib. And then Allah comes and tells us what? And then He comes and tells us, not only that I have placed love and mercy between your heart, no, your relationship is even far greater than that. أَنْتُمْ سَكَنٌ لَهُنْ. You are their abode. وَهُنَّ سَكَنٌ لَكُمْ. And you and they are your abode. What is better than your own home? Where do you find your rest other than your own home? And I'm not talking about a house. You can buy a house, but you can't buy a home. Right? You have to make the home. You have to make the home. You can't buy it. And it is on the basis of your characteristics that you make that home. Amir al-Mu'mineen was asked by one of the companions, what was your relationship like with Fatima salamullahi alayhi? What was it like? Tell us. We would love to know. He said, we were like two birds living in one nest. Two birds. You know, these canaries, the yellow ones, you know? Have you seen how they behave towards one another? Where the male, not the female, the male takes the seed and goes to the female canary and he drops the seed in her mouth. You know? And you see them warbling together in that nest. It is as if they are living a love story in front of you. An open book of how a wife should behave towards a husband and a husband should behave towards a wife. Yet, we don't ascribe to the law of Ahlul Bayt salamullahi alayhim and to the law of the Quran. And then we want to say we are the followers of Ahlul Bayt. How? Following means practice, brothers and sisters. Ya man tad'i al-hubb majana halla aqamta ala da'waka burhana. O you who claim to love, should you not substantiate your love with proof? Wallah, I love you, darling. And I've been living with you for 50 years. Not once I brought her a rose. What sort of love is this, man? What sort of love? I was better off at my parents' house. You know? At least my dad used to come and say, Betta, how are you? You want anything, darling? Do you want a cup of water at night when I'm studying? When you come home, it's like thunder has struck at the house. Because when you come in, you don't see positive, you only see negative. The minute you come into the house, you hear the tap in the last bathroom in the house dripping. You pick that up. Ooh! How many times I told you to lock the tap well? Ya akhi, before you tell her to lock the tap well, you go yourself and lock it. Diffuse the whole situation. Right? Don't create an issue out of nothing. Or better still, Your Highness, go and get a plumber for God's sake. And resolve the whole problem. Sallu ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Right? These are the akhlaq that we need to learn from our imams and from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the way we communicate with one another. And let us not stand against one another just for one shortfall. One shortfall. No. Let it go. Let it go. Doesn't matter. Reconcile it. Talk about it. You get angry with your wife, you get angry with your husband, go and bake a cake at night and invite him to a cup of cake, to a cup of coffee and a piece of cake. It's not gonna take away much of your time. Wallah, I don't know how to bake a cake. Wallah, there is a lot of sisters, you can ask them how to bake a cake for you. Right? Go to, I don't know, this Baker's Delight. I don't know if you have Baker's Delight here. And buy yourself a cake. Go to Forum, there is a nice cake shop in Forum. You know? Sallu ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. And get something. At least show some appreciation in that regard. And that's what the Imam salawatullahi wasalamu alayhi, he says that it is not in the nature of a brave man to ignore the mistakes that he has seen in others. What is our duty, brothers and sisters, is that if we find that people are lacking in morality, lacking in understanding, we should go down to their level and then raise them to our level. And not expect them to behave at our level. Because the Prophet ﷺ was the personality that was endowed with so much morality that when Allah describes his moral system, what does he say? He doesn't say, "Oh Muhammad, you have excellent manners." He says, "No, in fact, oh Muhammad, you sit on top of manners, and manners precipitate from under you." Subhanallah. Yani people come to you and they take manners from you like people take honey from the comb, from the honeycomb. You know how the honey drips? The Prophet drips morality. Salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. Drips morality. You have to be in that position where people look at you and they see that morality is oozing out of your system. Oozing out of your mouth, oozing out of your words, even oozing out of the way you breathe, because you breathe with love and consideration. You don't breathe with oof. Huh? Woman, God damn the day my mother introduced you to me, because it was the worst day in my life. And the wife will reciprocate. Wallah, I would rather be dead than be with you. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. These are cases that we are living on a daily basis, because we tend to forget the good times and we only focus on the bad times. Yet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala always tells us to focus on the positive as opposed to the negative. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says what? In regard to the relationship between husband and wife, what does he say? He says, surely you will stumble some negativeness among your wives, but always focus on the negative as opposed to the on the positive as opposed to the negative. Don't be a pessimistic person. Psychologist has proven optimistic people live longer. Subhanallah. Because they have the ability to be happy. They don't go under stress and depression. And Amir al-Mu'min and Imam Ja'far Sadiq, our sixth Imam, you know what he says? He says, a mu'min does not know depression. He does not know it because he knows how to relate to it and how to deal with it. Subhanallah. It's a matter of faith. It's a matter how you deal with a situation and an agony that hits you or a trial that comes your way. And then when his enemies, not only does the Imam forgive and forget, no, when it comes to his opponent, he even acknowledges their good points. And that is something difficult. Huh? That is something difficult to admit that, you know what, my opponent said something right. You would rather die than admit it. Right? Yet Amir al-Mu'mineen salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi says what in that regard? He says, sallu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. When he was with a group of his companions, and some of them heard some of their enemies saying something that they could not believe. They could not believe that they would say it. What did the Imam say? Salawatullahi wa salam. He says, when you hear something which is likely to benefit people, even if it comes from your opponent, then do not doubt the person saying it. Don't doubt him. Is there a benefit in what he's saying? Take it. Take it, but don't take his action if he acts contrary to what he's saying. Doesn't matter, take his word. If his actions are different to what he's saying, forget his action, take his word. Right? I don't want to go to this mosque because, you know, some people say something and do something else. Alright, is he saying something good? Take what he's there, what he's saying. You become the role interpreter of what he's saying. You put it in action so that maybe he will learn from you. He will learn that what he's teaching you, you are putting it in action. Right? And move forward in life in that regard. The Imam states, and his words are law, brothers and sisters. Yani the Imam, when he speaks, he is Imamun Muftaradu Ta'a. What does that mean? يعني his words are dictates of law that we must accept and abide by. Right? صلوات الله وسلامه عليه. When he speaks about people, he says people are your brothers. Why? Because they are either your brothers in religion or they are equal to you, as they too are the inhabitants of this earth like you. Therefore, forgive them and overlook their mistakes, as you expect the same attitude from your God. Subhanallah. Do you want your God to forgive you? طيب, find it in yourself to forgive first. Subhanallah. Otherwise, how could you stand in front of Allah and say, "Oh Allah, forgive me," but this guy, don't look at him, because I hate him. Right? How? Oh, Allah's mercy is so vast and abundant. Allah says, forgive your brother first. Forgive him, so that forgiveness and pardon will be overwhelming. Because when you turn to your brother and say, I forgive you, without him knowing even, Allah jumps in immediately and he says, what? You are not more generous than me. You are also included in that forgiveness. Subhanallah. What else do we want other than that, brothers and sisters, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala looks upon us with his eyes of mercy and his abundance of mercy, so that we can progress further and develop in this life. When his 11,000 bloodthirsty enemies prevented him from drawing water from the river so that he and his soldiers may die of thirst, what did the Imam do? Doesn't the Quran tell us an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth? Okay, but why didn't the Imam do that? Because we know when he dislodged the enemies in the battle of Nahrawan, when he dislodged them and took over the river, what did he do? He ordered his soldiers to break away from the enemy's line and to allow them to come and draw water and go back. His army went ballistic. They said, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, shortly, a while ago, they prevented us from reaching the water. Now you allow them. And the Imam salawatullahi salamu alayhi not only allow them, but you know what he says? He says, a person who dies fighting for the cause of Allah will not be rewarded as much as the man who forgives his enemies. Allahu Akbar. Why dislodge people from reaching what God made available to them? Water. But my heart goes to Hussein salamullah alayhi, when he was prevented, and not only him, but that tender age of 6 month baby, Aliyun al-Azghar. What يعني sin has Aliyun al-Azghar committed to be prevented from water? In any case. Look at the treatment of the Imam of his opponents, as opposed to the treatment of his opponents towards him. Salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. Why do we say this? Sallu ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Why do we say this? You can hear me still?
Yes.
Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. It looks more intimate anyway, like that, inshallah. So why do we say this, brothers and sisters? We say this because we want us to learn the characteristic and the behavioral pattern of our imams and our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, not only in times of felicity, but also in times of difficulty. Because that is when you prove your worth as a human being. When you are challenged. Not when you have everything running smoothly for you. Right? When you have money, you have a house, you have a wife, you have a car, you have children, and everything is running smoothly, you're happy. But when you are put to the test, that's when you prove to be among those who are truly sincere to what they believe in or not. Look what Imam Hussein salawatullahi wasalamu alayhi says in that regard. He says, "Inna al-din la'iqun 'ala al-sunin nas ma darrat ma'ayishahum, fa'idha hum muhsu qall al-dayyanun." Allahu Akbar. Imam Hussein says what? He says, religiousness to some people, or religion to some people, is like chewing gum. You know when you chew gum, ah, we are Muslims, mu'min, we love our imams, we love Islam, beautiful, our Islam is the best. Huh? There is nothing that compared to our Islam. But the imam then continue. But when they are put to the trial and the test, you will see that those who stick to religion are very few among people. Very few. They start complaining, why me? Huh? Why did I have to lose the Nasdaq and the Nikkei and the FTSE? You couldn't find anyone to hit him with his, you know, share market? Does it have to be me? You know? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I want you to grow. I want you to let go of this world and let me hear your voice a little bit. Because I love it when someone comes and appeal to me and says, Ya Allah. I love it to hear a man saying and appealing to me, Ya Allah, because you have been so far away from me, I miss your voice. And I want to hear it. And the only way I'm going to bring you back to me is if I, yani, take something from you. Because if I give you more, you're not going to say Alhamdulillah. Sometimes you forget it because you are too engrossed counting the money. Qarun was the cousin of Musa, salamullah alayhi. One day Qarun comes to Musa and says, Cuz, I'm saying this of course, okay. He says, hey cuz, you know, why don't you teach me one of those tricks of yours? You know, you change the sick into a serpent and I want to become rich. Musa says, listen cuz, richness is not for you because you may slip. And I don't want to lose you. You are a mu'min. You come to the mosque, you pray with me or whatever, the temple. You always, you know, inquire about your faith. I don't want to lose you. He says, no, don't you trust me? Cut the story short. He teaches him a formula. Honest to God, if each and every one of us now knows this formula, they will jump for it. What did he teach him? He teaches him how to change sand into gold. Whoa! Huh? There's a lot of sands in Pakistan. Imagine if you're living in the empty quarter in Saudi Arabia, you know, the desert, and you have the means to change sand into gold. He changes sand into gold, so much so that his wealth grows to such an extent that the Quran describes his wealth in Surah Qasas. It says what? It says, وَإِنَّ مَفَاتِحَهُ لَتَنُوءُ بِالْعُصْبَةِ أُولِي الْقُوَّةِ. He says, one key of his, it requires 9 people to carry one key to his treasures. 9 people. What happens? Musa calls him. He says, you know, this money has a tax on it. But this tax is for Allah. You know why? Because Allah gives you 100%. It's not your money. And then he says, just give me 20 back. And this 20 back is not for me. It's to sustain others. And even when you give that 20 back, I will quadruple it. And I will, you know, even make it bigger and greater up to 700 times. Qarun says, what are you talking about? I knew I was going to become rich. Allahu Akbar. He tells Musa, I knew. قال إنما أوتيته على علم عندي. He said, this wealth I have, I knew I was going to get it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala at that moment does not give Qarun respite. You know why? Because he gave him ample chances. He says to him what? فَخَسَفْنَا بِهِ وَبِدَارِهِ الْأَرْضِ. We issued our orders from heaven that the land splits open and swallows him and his wealth. And he's perished because he did not say, Ya Allah. He could not remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you know what? Allah says, even when I give you money, when I give you money, don't give money and then make us hear about you 1,000 times that you gave money. Because Allah says, قَوْلٌ مَعْرُوفٌ, a good word, خَيْرٌ مِّن صَدَقَةٍ يَتْبَعُهَا أَذَى. Allahu Akbar. A good word is much better than an act of charity followed by abuse. Allahu Akbar. You know, you sustain someone, you give him 1,000 rupees or 2,000 rupees. You know, 10 years ago I gave you this money. If it wasn't for me, you would be nowhere. Habibi, I would rather you didn't give it to me. But don't always come and bombard me with your statements of generosity. Right? No. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shapes our way and our behavior in how we reach out to people and how we deal with them. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says emotional hurt is much greater than physical hurt. Much greater than physical hurt. And that's why Amir al-Mu'mineen salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi, when he used to utter or act, he would act within the scales of justice. Because to Amir al-Mu'mineen, the appropriateness of the end cannot be justified and achieved without the soundness of the means. Right? In our case, what do we say? We say what? The end, the means justifies the end, even if the mean is crook. Right? But Amir al-Mu'mineen says, no. To achieve the end, the means has to be appropriate. They have to be just. They have to be equitable. Once Margaret Thatcher was asked, why don't you lift the sanction away from the Iraqi people during the reign of Saddam Hussein? When we are being told that 300,000 children are killed every month because of lack of medicine not entering Iraq due to the sanctions. You know what she said? She said the end or the means or the means justify the end. Yani the sanction justifies the ends by removing Saddam Hussein. To Amir al-Mu'mineen, he says, no, that is not right. That is not the right way or the methodology. You do not kill 300 people, you know? You do not kill 300,000 children in order to reach a tyrant at the end. Deal with the tyrant directly and allow these children to live with dignity and honor. Just like Amir al-Mu'mineen, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. Just like the children of Amir al-Mu'mineen behaved. Imam Zain al-Abideen, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. After the aftermath of Karbala, he goes back to Medina, right? And he lives in Medina. And he begins the process of communicating the aftermath of Karbala and the message of Karbala through what? Through the medium of dua. You know, he uses the dua and risalatul huquq, which we will look at it inshallah with the women's section or with the women lectures inshallah. Risalat, he reaches out to the people about Karbala through dua and risalatul huquq. And then what happens? And then Zainul Abideen salawatullahi wa salamu alayh, it's reported that he used to go and give rations at night while his face is covered. No one would know. He will come out at night, take some workers with him, carry the sacks of wheat on his back. Huh? He doesn't send his workers. He carries the sacks of wheat on his back. And then he goes door knocking. Knocks on the door. He leaves the scene, knocks on the door and walks away. No one knows who's putting these rations. Until Imam Zain al-Abideen dies, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi, these rations does not arrive at the door of these families in Medina. Historians began numbering the families that used to get these rations from Imam Zain al-Abideen. They found out 300 families a night they used to get this type of wheat from Imam Zain al-Abideen. This is nothing. Wait until you hear the end of the story. They counted to see among the 300 families who was who, and they found that the 300 families were from Bani Umayyah. From the very enemies of Ahlul Bayt, salamullahi alayhim. Why? Because the only way you can encompass your enemy is by being generous to him. Because you cannot give your enemy any right over you when he wants to kill you and you smile in his face. There is no justification after that for him to attack you. And when Abdul Malik ibn Marwan loses his grip over Sham because he could not rule it anymore. And he was the ruler of Medina that was given the orders to push Hussein out of Medina. Or he gives his bay'ah to Yazid. When he lost his reign, he sent his daughters to Medina for protection. Not a single house in Medina accepted his daughters, except the house of Ali Zainul Abidin, salawatullah wa salamu alayhi. He took his daughters in and he said, you will live in my house in as much and as equal as I treat my own daughters. This is humanity. This is what we need to learn from Ahlul Bayt salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. No wonder when Amirul Mu'mineen salawatullah wa salamu alayhi, he sees his killer in front of him, as I stated few days ago, and he sees that the chains are tight on his wrist. Today, brothers and sisters, the day that Jibra'il cried out in heaven, Al-Yawm Wallah Tahaddamat Arkan Al-Huda. Today by Allah, the pillars of guidance have come falling down and trembling down. Because Amir al-Mu'mineen represents these pillars of guidance. Ya Ali, anta ma'a al-haq wal-haq ma'a Ali, yaduru ma'ahu haythu ma dar. Surely, O Ali, the truth is with you, and you are with the truth, and the truth revolves with you wherever you go. It is not that Amir al-Mu'mineen revolves with the truth, it is the truth that revolves with Amir al-Mu'mineen. Salawatullahi wa salam. And that's why Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says to Ammar, O Ammar, if the entire human race went in one path and Ali ibn Abi Talib took another path, make sure you take the path of Ali ibn Abi Talib. Salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. In such a day, what crime Ali ibn Abi Talib committed for him to be struck in that way? Nothing except his justice. So much so that Amir al-Mu'mineen himself salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi says what? He says, ma taraka liya al-haqq sadiqa. By Allah, truth has left me abandoned without any friends and supporters. Because people cannot affiliate themselves with the truth, because the truth sometimes is difficult. You have to give up many things for the sake of the truth. So when his killer comes to him, and he was brought in while Imam Ali salawatullahi salamu alayhi is experiencing that torment of the death and the leaving of the soul from his body, he finds his killer tight so much that it begins to leave a mark on his wrist. Immediately Amir al-Mu'mineen says, oh Hassan, untie my killer, untie him and provide him with the same food you have provided me with. Sallallahu alayka ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, ya Ali ibn Abi Talib, ya ibn al-Atyab al-Tahirin, ya Sihra Rasulillah, وقائد الغر المحجلين إلى جنات النعيم. وين ابن ملجم was lying in the mosque of Kufa. أمير المؤمنين علي بن أبي طالب enters the masjid and the mosque of Kufa only to see his killer lying down on his tummy. أمير المؤمنين says to عبد الرحمن بن ملجم, O servant of Allah, change the way you are sleeping, for this is not befitting for someone who believes in Allah. Earlier, this Abdul Rahman ibn Muljam was in the army of Amir al-Mu'mineen. When he comes to him and he says to him, I am one of your soldiers, he says, what is your name? Abdul Rahman says, I am Abdul Rahman. He says, I am after your surname. What is your surname? The man repeats, I am Abdul Rahman. And the third time Amir al-Mu'mineen says, are you Ibn Muljam? He says, yes, ya Amir al-Mu'mineen. Amir al-Mu'mineen says, you shall be the one who will sever your relationship with Allah on account of killing me. One of the companions of Ali ibn Abi Talib. Look at the justice of Ali ibn Abi Talib, sisters and brothers. He said, oh Amir al-Mu'mineen, if you know that he is your killer, why don't you put him to death? He says, woe unto you. Allah has taught us not to take a criminal by his act of criminology before the act of the crime. We do not kill people for the sake of killing people. We cannot assume he has to commit the crime first. Then Abdul Rahman ibn Muljam, after Amir al-Mu'mineen, goes down to Sajda. Imagine, brothers and sisters, someone is in Sajda, helpless, helpless. He is between the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Goes down to Sajda. Abdul Rahman ibn Muljam takes out his sword, jumps at the back of Amir al-Mu'mineen, strikes him on his head. The blood comes from the head of Amir al-Mu'mineen, drenches his holy beard. Amir al-Mu'mineen looks towards heaven and he cries out, Fustu wa Rabbu al-Ka'ba. Surely I have scored triumph by the Lord of the house of Allah. Inna lillah wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Wa sayalamu alladhina zalamu ala Muhammadin ayya munqalabin yanqalibun. Al-Fatiha ma'a salawat ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.